There we go.
Welcome to True Hebrews United of the Lord Yeshua. This is your beloved holiness instructor, discipleship, Joe Sargent, about to get into the book. I definitely give all honor to Ahiah, who begot Yeshua, the only begotten of the Father, all the elders, the bishops, the apostles, the prophets, the deacons, the pastors, the teachers, the evangelists, all those people doing the work. Hey, keep seeking and saving that which is lost. All the members in the body, living clean and separate unto the Almighty. Keep standing. Don't drop standards. I know it gets tough. I know some of you guys don't have fellowship or financial struggles or marital problems. Whatever comes your way, hey, just hold on. You just got to live holy just until you die. That's it. You just got to live holy and righteous just until you die. Just keep holding on. So all those trying to be in the body, just making those first steps, this message will probably be perfect for you. But hey, keep going. Take those baby steps. Every step you take, the Almighty will take a step towards you. So with all that said, being done, let's let the fingers do the walking and scripture do the talking.
The scripture do the talking.
Scriptures do the talking, that's right. That's all right, we'll get it together. Yes. We'll get it together. Oh, I'm going to call up, call up Jeffrey, pressing through again. Here we go. Praise the Almighty, I appreciate you pressing.
Amen.
You want to say something to the people?
I just want to say, you know, bless everyone out there. I just want to wish you the best. Keep listening to the word, because the word will save you, will set you free. It's definitely starting to put a change in my life, and I know it can for you too. So God bless you all out there, and just keep listening to the word and let it lead you and take care of you. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you. We've got another visitor coming, pressing his way. Go and just say hi to the camera. Caesar. There you go. There you go.
Hello.
So let's do it. Let's get into the book. James chapter 4. James chapter 4. Ready for war. And we're going to start at verse 8. That'll be 13:18, page 13:18.
Amen.
And the pages are here, so 13:18.
Okay.
There you go. Praise Almighty. James chapter 4. We're going to start at verse 8. It says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. So that's my main point. You take those steps to the Almighty, and he'll take a step to you. Today, if you decide to take one step, he'll take one step. Tomorrow, if you decide to take 1 mile, he'll take a mile towards you too. Let's keep going. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep, and let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourself in the sight of the Almighty, and he shall lift you up. He'll raise you up. It says he gives grace to the humble. But my main point is I want to deal with verse 8. It says, draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. That's a promise. He's faithful. It's impossible for the Almighty to lie. You make those steps to the Almighty, and he will meet you right where you are. So let's go to 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles chapter 16. And that'll be 502. 2 Chronicles chapter 16. We're going to start at verse 9. First Chronicles, my bad. Second Chronicles, chapter 16. I got you guys messed up. That'll be 534. Second Chronicles. Starting at verse 9, I'll wait until all you guys get
Amen.
It. All right, cool. So it says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to shew himself strong on the behalf of them whose heart is perfect towards him. Herein thou hast done foolishly, therefore thou shalt, from henceforth thou shalt have words. So he's dealing with the king that was unfaithful. But he's a prophet saying, the eyes of the Almighty going to and fro the whole earth to show himself strong whose heart is perfect before him. So this is why it says, if you draw nigh to me, you make a step towards me, I'll show myself to you. I'll show myself strong. I'm looking for people that wants to come to me. I'm looking for people that wants to have a heart to seek their maker, to seek their heavenly father. You make those steps, draw nigh to me, and I'll draw nigh. I'll meet you right where you're at. And let's keep going. So let's go to Luke 18. He goes to and fro the whole earth. No matter where you live on this planet, if you have a heart to be right with your maker, to know your maker, Hey, who'll meet you? Luke 18. And what's there at Luke chapter 18? What's that verse 1?
Amen.
That'd be 11:35. Say amen when you got it. No, well, no. Or say I got it or something. He spake, and not for you, it's just because I'd rather have the YouTube, Facebook people wait and people here get edification, and they just got to get what you can get. Don't have a fit. So, and he spake a parable unto them, unto this end, that men ought always to pray, not to faint. So it says, hey, we always got to seek the, don't get tired to seek the Almighty. Don't get tired. Oh, I'm too tired to pray. It said, men ought always to pray and not to faint. Don't get weary and faint and not praying. Saying, there was in a city a judge, which feareth not God, neither regardeth man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterwards he said within himself, though I fear not God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubled me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust said, judge saith, shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man come, shall he find faith on earth? Now, we just read a scripture. I'll deal with this. He says, don't get tired of praying. Then he uses this example how that woman kept praying, kept seeking. And he says, we need to mimic that widow woman and keep seeking the Almighty. If we really want a prayer answered, maybe you got to come. It might take 6 months. It might take 3 years. Time is not a factor with the Almighty. But I'm not dealing with prayer right now. But my main point is saying, hey, you should be seeking the Almighty. But when the Almighty comes, will he find faith on earth? Will he find people still drawing nigh unto him? Now, with the scripture we read before, it says the Almighty goes to and fro the whole earth to shew himself strong on the behalf of those hearts who's perfect before him. Now we see another scripture says when the Almighty comes, when you find people still seeking him, still drawing nigh, still making those steps towards their makers, towards their creator, towards the true and living God, towards the Almighty. So, let's see some examples. Acts chapter 8. I'll show you some examples where, hey, you just try your best and the Almighty will meet you. It doesn't matter how much or how little you know. Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. And we're going to start at verse 26. That'll be 1191.
Amen.
You're doing good. Hopefully we can get it all in one recording. It doesn't mess up. Cool. So, Acts chapter 8, verse 26. And we begin. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, arise, go towards the south unto the way that goeth down to Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is in the desert. And he arose and went. And behold, a man, an Ethiopian eunuch, in great authority under Candace, queen of Ethiopians, had charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem to worship. So he knew to worship, but he didn't know about the Messiah. He knew he needed to be at Jerusalem, so he was in the old covenant, came to Messiah, died, rose again the third day. So he was still keeping the law and the covenants, waiting for the Messiah to come. He did not know that the Messiah came already. And so it was returning, sitting in his chariot from reading Isaiah the prophet. So he's coming from the right place, he's reading the right book. He just lacks. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself unto the chariot. And Philip ran there and heard him read the prophet Isaiah and said, understand what thou readest? And he said, how can I except some men guide me? And that goes here, all you YouTube and Facebook disciples, you need to find a watchman for your soul. It says, and I gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and for teachers for the perfection of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. You need a watchman for your soul. So he says, how can I except some man guide me? And he desired Philip, he would come up and sit down with him. And the place of the scripture where he read was, he was led as a sheep to the slaughter and like a lamb dumb before his shearers, so he opened not his mouth. He just happened to be reading a prophecy of the Messiah. Like, what are the coincidences of that? What is this? And then he doesn't know that the Messiah came and already died for his sins. So let's keep going. And then the place of the scripture was read, we'll go in verse 33. In his humility, his judgment was taken away. Who shall declare his generation? For his life was taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh thou this prophet, of himself or some other person? Then Philip opened his mouth and began to preach at the same scripture and preached unto him Yeshua. And they went on their way and came to a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Yeshua HaMashiach is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they were both down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized them. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went his way rejoicing. But Philip was found at Azotus, passing through and preaching all the cities till he came to Caesarea. So, this man, he didn't have understanding of the Messiah, but he was drawn nigh unto the Almighty. So the Almighty sent an angel to talk to Philip. He sent an evangelist. He had a divine appointment. Here's someone drawing nigh to me. Here, go talk to him. Go talk to him. And that's what he's saying. Draw nigh to me and I'll draw nigh to you. The Almighty is going to and fro the whole earth. And he's willing to, hey, I'll show you. You want to know your maker? I'll reveal myself. But you got to make these steps. You got to put effort. You got to make those, whether it's a baby step or maybe it's a stride, a full-on spread, whatever pace the Almighty set before you got to run it. The Almighty, when he came in the gospel, he gave me a sprint and pace. So I just start growing super fast in the gospel. Knowledge, everything, obedience, discipline, because this is my stride. You might be a person that where you just take your steps, nice steps, but you can't go slower than what he said before you. And just like me, I'm a sprinter, but I cannot be a walk. I can't, no. I got to stick with the same pace he set before me too. I always got to sprint towards the Almighty because everyone has different callings and different abilities. So we see here is, look, this man, the Almighty, he'll draw nigh to him. The Ethiopian was coming from the right place, reading the right book, reading the scriptures, and he didn't have understanding. Don't even worry. I'll give you someone that has understanding. I'll give them to you. You know, so let's get another example. Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10.
Amen.
There was a certain man. I'm gonna read a little bit fast. I know Danielle. I know I read fast, but when I gotta read the whole chapter, I gotta go quick. So bear with me. Ready? There was a certain man in Cornelius in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion called the Italian man, a devout man, one that feared of God with all his house and gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. So he was a Gentile, but he converted. He converted and started serving the true living Ahiah, and he just didn't know that the Messiah came and died for his sins. So people in the Old Testament, if you will, that were living before Christ came, they were serving the Almighty, keeping the laws, the statutes, the judgments, and following the prophets, but they're waiting for that Messiah. They don't know what time, what year, what date. They've been waiting for the Messiah to come. So he didn't know that the Messiah came and died for his sins yet. So let's see what happened. He's seeking the Almighty speedily. He's praying to God always and giving much alms to the people. Let's see what happens. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour on the day, an angel of God coming unto him, saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked at him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thy alms have gone up for a memorial before God. And now send men to Joppa and call one for Simon, whose surname is Peter. So he said, you know what? I know you're trying to seek me. Go. I'm going to get you an apostle to come to your house. He said, in a vision, the Almighty, an angel spoke to him in a vision and said, you're drawing nigh to me and you don't have understanding. Guess what? I'm going to send an apostle to come to you and give you understanding. Let's keep going. Verse 6. He looked for one Simon a tanner whose house is by the seaside, and he'll tell thee what thou oughtest to do. And when the angel was spake unto Cornelius, departed, he called two of his household servants, devout soldiers unto them that waited unto him continuously. And when he had declared these things unto him, he sent them to Joppa. And on the morrow, as they went on the journey, he drew nigh unto the city. Peter went up into the housetop to pray about the sixth hour, and became very hungry, and he would have eaten. But while he made ready, he fell into a trance, and he saw heaven open up and certain vessels descend unto him that had been a great sheet knit for four corners and let down on the earth. Wherefore all manners of four-footed beasts of the earth, wild beasts and creeping things and fowls of the air. And there came a voice unto him, rise, kill, and eat. And Peter said, not so. I have never eat anything that is common and unclean, because it was pigs and all those unclean animals that was against the law. And so he's seen a vision, says, kill and eat it. He says, no, I haven't ate anything common and unclean. Why would Peter say that if the law is done away with and you can eat swine? But we're going to get into this later, because they use this scripture to justify why you can eat pig. And I'm going to prove that these people need to finish the rest of this chapter. So let's keep going. So the Peter said, not so, Lord, I have never eaten anything common that is unclean. And the voice spake unto him again the second time, what God hath cleansed, thou call not thou common. See, that means you can't eat pork, and you can't eat squid and shrimp and crab. Now see, he got a dream. He's saying you can eat that. Let's see what he's talking about. It says, verse 15, what God hath cleansed, thou call not thou common. All right, so he's talking about all those meats, right? This was done thrice, and the vessels were received up again into heaven. And while Peter doubted in himself what this vision he had seen means, like, does that mean I can eat pork? The men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate, and called and asked whether Simon, which is surnamed Peter, his last name was Peter, that's why it's not, you know, there's nothing wrong with going by your last name, because people always call him the Apostle Peter, but his first name is actually Simon. His last name is Peter. But let's keep going. Which lies there. While Peter thought on those visions, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore and get thee down and go with thee, doubting nothing, and I have sent them. So while he's thinking about this vision, three people popped up and say, hey, I'm looking for Simon and Peter. And he's like, I'm just not going to just go with you. And the Spirit said, hey, go with them, because I sent them unto you. So verse 21. Then Peter went down down to the men which were sent unto him from Cornelius, and said, behold, I am he whom you seek. What is the cause wherefore you are come? And they said, Cornelius, a centurion, a just man, one that fear of God and of good report among all the nation of the Jews, was warned from God by an angel to send for thee into the house to hear the words of thee. Then called he them and lodged there, and on the morrow Peter went away with them, and certain brethren with Joppa accompanied him. And on the morrow after they entered into Caesarea, Cornelius waited unto him, and he called his kinsmen and his near friends. And Peter was coming into Cornelius, met him, and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter took him up, saying, stand up, I myself am also a man. And he asked, and as he talked with them, he went in and found many that were come together. And he said unto them, ye know that it is unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or to come into another nation. But God hath shewed me that I shall not call any man common or unclean. So that dream does not justify eating pig. He's talking about the Gentiles, because the gospel, Christ only came. He says, I'm not sent to the lost sheep of Israel. So now he had to give Peter that dream, because they were only preaching the Jews, to say, hey, I'm opening the door to salvation to the Gentiles too. So these Christians try to use that vision and justify eating pig. But he says, the Almighty revealed to me through a dream. Don't be calling the Gentiles common and unclean. Hey, you know what? They're not what God has cleaned. So let's keep going. So, verse 29. Therefore I came unto you without gainsaying as soon as I was sent for. I asked therefore, what was the intent that you sent me? And Cornelius 4 days ago was fasting unto the hour, and at the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in a bright clothing, and said, Cornelius, thy prayer in there is heard, and thy alms are had in remembrance into God, remembrance in the sight of God. Send therefore to Simon, and call there Simon, whose surname is Peter. He lodgeth in the house of Simon a tanner by the seaside, who when he commanded shall speak unto thee. Immediately therefore I sent unto thee, that thou hast well done, and thou art come. Now therefore are we all here present before God to hear all the things that thou commandest thee of God. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of the truth I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is acceptable unto him. See? So this is what that dream was about. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Yeshua HaMashiach, he is the Lord of all. The word which I say unto you, know ye, which was published throughout Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism of John preached, how God anointed Yeshua of Nazareth, which with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we are his witnesses unto all which he had did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hang on a tree. Him God raised the third day to shew him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before God, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which ordained of God to be judge of the quick and the dead. To him give all the prophets witness through his name. Whosoever believeth in him shall receive remissions of sins. And while Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them, and they heard, and which heard the word. And they were of the circumcised which believed were astonished, as many of them that came to with Peter, because on the Gentiles also was poured the gift of the Holy Ghost. So it's like, what? Christ only came to the Jews, and now we see the Gentiles receiving the Holy Spirit too? They were like, what? This is weird. This is strange. I've never seen that happen. So let's keep going. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then asked Sir Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as we as well? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then they prayed thee him to tarry certain days. So I know it was long, but it says, hey, Cornelius was praying. He didn't know the Messiah came, but he was diligent. He knew he had a relationship with the Almighty. And so what? He draw nigh to the Almighty drew nigh to him. He sent him an apostle. Out of every person that could have came and gave him the gospel, he's like, guess what? I'm going to give you one of my best. I'll send you an apostle. Tell you what do you need to do. So this is why I'm saying, hey, if we draw nigh, he's faithful. Let's keep going. John chapter 4. Gospel John chapter 4. And that will be verse 1. All right. I got to read a little bit again. All right. Ready? That'll be 1151. What? 1151. You ready?
Amen.
Get, bear with us. I'll begin a new banner. Praise the Almighty. It's already in the making. John chapter 4, verse 1. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Yeshua had made baptism more than the disciples of John, through Yeshua himself baptized not but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again unto Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, and near a parcel of ground unto Jacob gave his son Joseph. And Joseph's well was there that he dug. You can read that in the book of Genesis. And Yeshua was there. Yeshua, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Then cometh a woman of Samaria, and drew of water, and said, and Yeshua said unto him, give me drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest to drink of me, which am a Samaritan? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. So this is why when we read the book of Acts, when Christ actually died again and rose again, he said, it's not lawful for me to go into another nation. So he knew the law. The Almighty had to give him a dream 3 times so he could grasp, okay, it's okay for me to preach to the Gentiles. So this gives you the outlook of how what was going on in the mindset of the Jews and the heathen at that time. So let's keep going. And Yeshua asked and said unto him, if thou knewest the gift of God, who is it that said unto thee, give me drink, thou would have asked of him, and he would have given thee a living water. And the woman said unto him, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Yeshua answered and said unto him, whosoever drinketh this water shall thirst again, but whoever drinketh of the water that I shall give you shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give thee shall be in him as a well of water springing up into everlasting life. He was referring to the Ruach HaKodesh, the spirit of separation, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. So let's keep going. Check this out. So she didn't know. Look at this question. The woman said unto them, sir, give me this water that I may thirst, neither come here or there to draw. So she didn't know that he was talking about the Holy Spirit. So immediately she asked, hey, you know what? I want that water. She didn't know she was asking for the Holy Spirit, though. I want that water, right? Look what Yeshua said. Yeshua said unto him, go call thy husband to come. First thing he dealt with was sin. Oh, you want the spirit? Go call your husband. Let's see what she says. The woman answered and said, I have.